Hey, roommates. I'm gonna need you to pull up a chair for this conversation because we're sitting down with an activist, an author, a podcaster. Many of you know her as the founder of Until Freedom, but I know her as a black queen who pours so much into our community. So, Tamika Mallory, thank you for stepping into the shade room.
In the shade room. This is cool. I actually get to be in the room.
Yes, and it's all tea, no shade, as you know, because we did an interview several months back.
Sure did.
On IG Live.
Yeah.
You was rolling around in the car. You were going to go speak to some children.
Yeah.
Yes.
I'm always moved. That's the life of an activist, but I'm glad to be here with you. You look great.
You look amazing, but I know you look amazing because I've technically seen you before out there in Minneapolis.
Yeah, that was just a few days ago, right?
Yeah, like it was just last week, and you were with Jesse Jackson. You were looking great in the hotel. I was like, oh my gosh, that's Tamika. I'll see you next week. But it's so good to have you here. Now, speaking of that interview we had several months ago, you know, at that time, there was a lot of black death just being circulated online. Like we saw, it was George Floyd's video.
Right.
And, you know, people were talking about how that's affecting everyone, but especially black people's mental health.
Yeah.
And here we are several months later, and it's the same thing.
Yeah.
We're seeing Dante Wright's video.
Absolutely.
Makaia Bryant's video. It's just a lot going on. How are you, as someone who's working on the front lines, holding up emotionally and mentally?
Well, you know, unfortunately, or I guess fortunately for my own mental capacity to deal with all of this, I've been doing it for a long time. I've been engaged in the struggle for justice, if you will, for so long that I've learned a few techniques. And the first thing is that I don't really watch videos.
Okay.
That's something that I stopped a while ago. And until right before the trial began, I had not watched the video of George Floyd throughout. You know, I saw, you know, obviously I saw him on the ground. I knew that the former officer had a knee in his neck, and I heard the cries from George Floyd for his mother. And so I knew what happened in essence, but I never sat and watched at that time what we thought was 8 minutes and 46 seconds of a video. And many others I have not watched. And that's something that over many years I've had to learn that I could tell the trigger of watching the videos. I was not in a position to do my job properly, you know, just too emotional. You know, oftentimes so angry that I was not able to, have a stable conversation. I knew that that was troubling to me. And then, you know, I also would find myself not sleeping properly through the night, which is still a challenge. You know, the other thing I would say is that I get way more videos than what the general public has an opportunity to see. A lot of times, we watch viral videos and we get access to viral moments or to things that have outraged the entire community. But in my situation, people send me clips, they send me videos, they send me things all the time asking if I can help or look at this and, you know, make a determination of whether or not there is a case that is strong enough to you know, fight for a particular family or individual. And so
how do you decide that?
Well, you know, there's a lot of factors that go into deciding. First of all, the heartstrings matter. You know, for me, I can, you know, when I heard the story of Breonna Taylor, I knew it wasn't going to be easy. You know, I understood that they had already criminalized her. It had been some time between when she died and when I finally got the call, maybe 2.5 months later. People didn't even know across the country and now across the world that Breonna had been killed by police. Her boyfriend fired a warning shot. So, you know, we already knew that there would be the issue around, you know, whether or not his bullet entered the officer and if that's what sparked them to shoot back. So there was a lot of complications, and I can tell you that a lot of people, such as in the case of Makaia Bryant, look for perfect victims. They look for it to be a perfect situation so that when they get involved, they don't have to deal with but so much pushback. But in my situation, just understanding the dynamics of Black America and all that we go through every day and how, you know, and when I look at Makaia Bryant's situation, you know, I recognize the trauma and her entire life, that everything that she probably has ever been through as a 16-year-old played out in those few seconds of that fight.
It did, you know? And we got to get into that. Yeah. So she was a foster child.
Right.
And I connect to Micaiah, and this is part of why I was snapping on some people who were trying to justify her death, because I was a foster child too. Right. And I know that that system can leave you unprotected.
Right.
And just seeing that she is obviously the one who called the police, she felt threatened.
Well, there are there is some conflict around who called, but what I'm sure about is that either Micaiah or her young sister Janiyah, who happens to also, Breonna Taylor's little sister's name is Janiyah.
I was gonna say,
and
Janiyah.
So is Micaiah's, okay. Both Janiyah's. It's a coincidence that's unbelievable.
Right.
You know, either Janiyah or Micaiah called, right? There's obviously an investigation. Hopefully those things will be made clear. But it is very, very evident from the phone, from the conversation, from the 911 tape, that there is someone saying there's a problem here, mm-hmm. And we need protection. We need people to come and show up for protection.
And there were adults that were around, though, and that makes people wonder, like, why are these adults not able to intervene and stuff like that? It just seems like there's system on top of system on top of system that failed Micaiah.
Well, it's not just adults that were around. Mm-hmm. There were adults involved in the fight.
Wow.
And I know that from her family. I talked to her family members, and they have stated so. So, you know, there's a lot that happened there. And so to your point about choosing cases and choosing families to support, usually for me, we go towards the most difficult because I think in the situations that are most difficult, it gives us the ability, one, to support our theory that those people who are most oppressed have to be at the forefront of the solutions in the movement. So if that's the case, then you got to work with people who are not that buttoned up, right?
Right.
They're not, their story isn't perfect.
Mm-hmm.
But it also helps to frame the larger issue of what we're dealing with in society. So when you have foster care as a clear component in what happened to Micaiah, that gives us an opportunity to talk about the foster care system.
Right.
It gives us an opportunity to look at all the things that failed her, all the issues surrounding, you know, all of the people I've worked with, and to be able to talk about more than just a few seconds between a police officer's encounter mm-hmm. with an individual. We want to be able to provide for our own communities and to use some of the resources that are going into public safety from a policing standpoint and shift those resources to deal with more community approaches to violence and mental health and other issues.
Okay, so you are someone that supports defunding the police.
1,000%.
So you're saying, like, take the funding from police, and then, for example, in this situation with Micaiah Bryant, there would have been maybe a social worker on the scene or somebody else to de-escalate?
Right. So in New York City alone, the policing budget is $6 billion a year.
Wow.
Obviously, it's the biggest city, the target for all things terrorism and mm-hmm. you name the issues, it happens in New York. So we know that there's going to be some inflation of the budget around public safety or policing, because when you say public safety, that gets to be very, very tricky, because it's who, safety for who
mm-hmm.
and safety how. But you know, $6 billion is that number. Meanwhile, when you think of things again, all the other services, and you put them together, in many cases, it falls short of the $6 billion that's going to one particular component. And we think that is outrageous. It's very clear, by the way, that it's not fixing the problem, right?
Right.
We know that. We know, and when we're looking just right now, after a pandemic, violence is up all over the nation. People have clearly began to suffer from some real mental health issues as it relates to, you know, being locked in their homes, maybe not having the resources, having lost their jobs, having lost programs, businesses closing. There have been studies that show that when you walk through your community and everything is boarded up, that's not good for your mental health. Not, you know, for not just people who have a history of mental illness. We're talking about me, you and me, right? Like, mm-hmm. it's not good for us to see our communities in this shape.
You say boarded up as in, like, these are businesses that are
closed
down.
Closed businesses that are closed.
I was like, maybe it's the protest. I don't know, because they boarded
that's true. Right. In some cities, there has been a lot more boarding up of, you know, putting the construction boards out because of protests. But if you really travel through a place like New York City, mm-hmm. you can tell downtown that we've gone through something drastic. Businesses are gone.
Yeah.
Businesses have closed, and many of them are not coming back. And even those who are trying to come back, they can't find the staff. I mean, there's so many layers of problems that happened as a result of this pandemic, which basically exposed to the world, in my judgment, just how vulnerable and how unstable America is. The difference is that people with resources, people who live in communities that have resources and people who have money, and a lot of times white folks or people who are not black, they are able to go get a pill from a doctor to help deal with their anxiety issues. They can go sit on someone's couch, talk through issues. But where does Ray Ray on a street corner go when he has lost his job and now is back on the same streets that he's fought so hard to get away from? Mm-hmm. So we're dealing with a multitude of concerns. And I think that for a police department to have the resources, and we see that they're getting all the money, but the violence, the numbers are still going up, that's a problem.
Honestly, yeah. So, you know, with the work you do, how has activism impacted you, your family, your relationships, and obviously the things that you teach your son?
Well, first of all, you know, you can help everybody in the world and still struggle to deal with your own, you know, because it's where you're most vulnerable. It's where people know you. You know, my child knows me better than anybody in the world. Sometimes he'll come in the house and, you know, I'm working in the bed, on the couch, wherever it is, and I look crazy, like completely. This is before the Zoom world where you have to get up in the morning and beat your face, get your whole self together. Mm-hmm. I look so crazy, and he'll say to me, you know, Mom, if people could see, if they could see you or hear you and how you're like, with everything you're going through, he's like, they would, you know, they wouldn't believe it. So when you talk about teaching my son, instead of it being that I'm teaching him, we have grown up together. I learned so much from the young people that I'm around, and I'm around many of them. And my son is, you know, obviously one. You know, everything from when I get dressed, he's like, yo, that is corny. Like, you cannot wear that at all. Like, that's, you're going to be laughed at, you know. And of course, I still wear it because I'm like, I'm old, so you need to.
You don't look it. When I saw yours, I'm like, he's this old? I know black don't crack, but dang, yeah, like, it's really not cracking.
I'll be 41 in a few weeks. So,
wow.
You know,
41 is young, though, so I guess.
Yeah, but it's still like, I want the old stuff. Like, he's into the whole, you know, like, Mom, you need to be more cool.
I remember you saying on that IG Live interview we did that there were some suspicious groups that would, like, fly drones over your house.
Oh,
and then
gosh.
I don't know how social media is helping them find you a little
gosh.
Bit more now. And again, you are a lot more visible. You're on billboards on, I don't know if it's Hollywood Boulevard, Sunset Boulevard. I can't remember off the top. But the point is, are you still facing that kind of threat right now? Like, are they still following you?
I was in Louisville, Kentucky for Breonna Taylor's the 1 year anniversary or commemoration of her being killed. And as I was leaving the protest, we're separating. I'm going, you know, along with a group that I was with.
Mm-hmm.
There was a drone. And the thing about it is that these drones don't just follow me, because, you know, there can be a drone that's off in the air and you don't really pay attention to it because they're always around if you really look. And I'm one of these people that actually is outside, like, looking for, you know, equipment in the air. But they do things, intimidation tactics, because it got down as low as possible and literally walked with me directly for about 5 blocks.
I'm not laughing because it's funny. I'm laughing because of the audacity.
The audacity. And I mean, it was to the point where, and I have pictures of it. Like, literally, I can send you pictures and videos that other photographers who were with us, they saw what was happening. They ran over and started to take video and pictures of how close it was. Like, as I'm walking, it's walking with me. And so finally I'm like, well, hey,
you
then
way
you
better
know what I'm
yeah.
saying? Clearly you want to say what it is, what's up. And then finally, you know, it kind of goes off after you acknowledge that it's there, or that they are there, whoever they may
whoever,
be.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Because there have been times when there have been drones following us, I had three over my car one day.
Oh my gosh.
And just a few months ago, I got pictures of that too. And, you know, when I called several people that I know who work within the police department and asked, like, why are y'all following me like this? Like, or following my organization, the co-founders, because we were all in the car together. Mm-hmm. And they said, we'll call you back, because they didn't know, clearly. And usually they do. Usually they'll say, well, one, it's a curfew and you're outside, so we're getting ready to arrest you if you don't get home by such. They're not nice. They're like, this is why. Two, there's suspicion of, you know, possible arson, you know, rioting. They don't care. And they're like, and you're no different. Like, if you're out there, we're watching you too to see whether or not you are in, you know, inciting any potential danger, which we're not. And that's not what we do. And they know that, but there's it's still an intimidation tactic that they use. Right. And so I'll call and I'll ask, and they'll be like, you know, let's see what's going on. We'll check in with, you know, whoever. And they called me back and said, we don't have anything here where we're surveilling you today.
Well, do you think it's the FBI and a little bit more? I just watched Judas and the Black Messiah, you never know.
I mean, the sad part about it is that the place that this had, and I'm not gonna disclose exactly where it was, but the place where this happened, every day we also dealt with white supremacists. Mm. And so it could be anybody, and we don't know. Right? So I don't know who that was over me. I have no idea. But the thing is, I'm at the point in my life where I realize what I do every day. And as much as my mouth is always going, as you can see, I can talk. And, you know, when you talk a lot and you're a Black person and particularly a Black woman, there are people who want to shut you up. Everybody's not going to like you. That's just it. It's you just can't.
That leads to my next
point.
They're
not going to like
you. You're doing a lot of work. People did not know that you only were home 3 days in the last month plus.
I mean, that's just what it
people
is.
People get to see you at the Grammys and they think, oh, look at how fun, you know, whatever, whatever, you know, right. This, that, and the third. So speaking of people who don't like you.
And there's some folks, trust me. I always say, and they don't like me, and sometimes I don't like them back. Right? So there we go. That's okay. But the real question is, are we fighting for Black people? That's all we need to know.
Now, that's a question that Samaria Rice, Tamir Rice's mother, had. Mm-hmm. She kind of called you out publicly, did all that
sure
stuff.
Did.
She was saying, you know, basically, like, celebrity activists are ingenuine or they're capitalizing off of Black death.
So I wasn't a celebrity and then I became an activist.
Right, right, right.
Right, so that's important for people to understand the direction in which notoriety came. It came from real work that I've been doing for a long time. I've been organizing for 25 years of my life. People know me. This is not a new thing. You know, you can check with hoods across this country and people are like, no, I know Tamika Mallory. She was either here or she was engaged in this fight. And particularly in New York, which is my city, where we dealt with violence. We dealt with police violence. We still deal with those issues. And I've been a part of, as I mentioned, the crisis management system development and a lot of work from Sean Bell to Amadou Diallo to the Jersey Four. I mean, these are things I was a little girl out there engaged in this work and have continued.
You've been doing this my whole life. I just want you to know. You said 25 years. Right. You've been doing this my whole life.
So, yeah. So this is a long time. And you know, I could go on and on with, you know, in New York, we were a part of helping to change the law.
You're not new to this. You're true to this.
This is not new at all.
Yeah, yeah,
and so there have been people who have said, and I'm not talking about Samaria Rice. I believe that Ms. Rice is a grieving mother who has the right to say all of us are full of shit. Like, every single one of us. Because anytime a child is killed and we don't stop the world to get justice and at least to make it very clear that we're not going back to business as usual, we all have failed. So I have nothing to say about that. But my record, you can't challenge. That is clear. And I think it's important that even when we're critiquing one another, that we do it with facts. And you know, and it doesn't matter what shoes I wear, doesn't matter what clothes, because trust me, I'm gonna be cute. Forever. And I work hard to be able to do that, right? I work hard and I make sure that I bust my behind in a way that gives me the ability to have some things that make me feel happy in life, right? Because you're dealing with trauma all day long, which, by the way, many of the people who I see online who are challenging whether I'm doing it right and, you know, and they don't like how I move, they don't like how I dress, they don't like this and that, I don't see them outside. I don't see them. I don't bump into them when I'm sitting, you know, in the middle of a project having people really go off on me because they're like, hey, you showed up here. Like, what can you do to help us with this laundry list of problems? And I'm there with little resources trying to deal with some small part of an issue that's happening in their community. Right. They're not, these other folks that's making YouTube videos and, you know, critiquing us and trying to tear down those of us who have put our lives on the line, you're not out there. So So my whole thing that I've been saying is fine. I'm not gonna stop. That's not gonna happen, you know, because this is what I know is what God called me to do. And you and me are not on God's level. So you're not gonna stop me from doing what I know I'm supposed to do, but just outwork me. Show me how to do it. Show me the right way.
Okay, maybe you had time today.
Yeah, I'll shift to your way. Since you know better the right way to deal with white supremacy, racism, deep-rooted oppression. None of us have the full answer. I understand that there are people who say, well, you're not radical enough. Maybe I'm not. I understand that there are people that say, you're too radical. Because guess what? I get that too. When I'm talking to the black bourgeoisie, they're like, do you have to be so loud? You know, do you have to say this word? And do you have to curse, you know, when you're making your point? I have to deal with that as well. And then when I talk to some people who, you know, are more, you know, considered to be more grassroots, they're like, yo, you ain't radical enough. You ain't tearing it down. They like, yo, you should go out here, you know, and we should just run up in there and tell her, okay, well then you run first. And once you get through the door, I'm coming through. It's a bunch of talk. And there's really nothing to back it up.
Okay. Well, now you mentioned, you said one thing you gonna do is be cute.
Oh, absolutely.
Do you know what a snacktivist is?
No, am I a snacktivist?
You're a snacktivist.
Is that a new term?
It's a new term. Okay. Because some of these activists, I'd be like, we be looking at them like, okay. And, you know, in between posts about, you know, certain families who are going through it with obviously like police violence or, you know.
Fighting for
legislation and stuff like that. You know, you slip out a little post of you in a dress. Yeah, and we'd be like, dang, Tamika, she really doing it. So what are your DMs looking like? What's your dating life looking like? I mean, if you've only been home 3 days in the last month plus, we got to get into this. Like, how are you dating?
Well, I mean, first of all, there's not really a lot of people in my DMs as much as folks think.
Oh, okay.
I think there is, it's probably right. Sometimes it makes you feel a little like, well, why not me? But, you know, I've had many of my brothers explain to me that it's actually a respect thing, you know, and I begin to look at it that way, that people are like, you know, either I ain't ready for what I know she deserves, you know.
They haven't done the required readings yet. I mean,
I'm not looking for somebody who's done the required readings.
Okay.
Because the last thing I want to do when I get home
is talk more.
Talk more about the stuff that I have to deal with all day. They need to be conscious enough to know, though, that we're in a fight. We're in a war. And they need to have some role, even if that role is supporting me. But it can't be somebody who's completely oblivious and also unconscious and just like, I don't care about that. I can't do that. I have to have somebody that gets it. But they don't have to know all the required reading and words and all of that. I also think some folks are just intimidated.
I was going to say, I can't think
rough
from a man's perspective, but they probably maybe a little intimidated.
I'm a little rough around the edge.
So if somebody wants to be Tamika's lover, they got to get with Finish the Line.
If somebody wants, they just need to come correct. Like, you just, Anthony Hamilton said one day, when I was doing an interview with him on Street Politicians, my podcast with my son, and we asked him, I think I said, Anthony, are you dating? And he was like, no. And I said, are you looking? He said, yeah, but they got to have a job. They got to have their own job. You have to come, like, that, at least that.
Yeah.
You need to have your own resources. because I'm certainly coming to the table with all that I have worked really, really hard for, and they got to have that. So, you know, because there's some brothers out here that think, you know, they can live off of you, and that's not going to happen. But otherwise, I'm just looking for somebody who's cool, you know, who's fun and who's fit.
Okay.
They got to be fun, cool, and fit, right?
Because you snatch, so, you know, it's only fair.
Yeah, you know, so it's a simple thing. It's not that hard. It seems like it's not that hard. But based upon my girlfriends and what I hear about their stories, when I finally sit down and call them and say, what's going on, it seems like it's harder than I think to find that special love interest.
Okay, especially for, you know, somebody who's a powerhouse like you, I could see that. Well, May 11th, the book comes out.
The book comes out.
When does the Audible, I'm one of those people, I like watching documentaries, I like listening to books in the audio version. I'm too fidgety to be sitting down, that's just what it is.
So well, social media has done that to us.
It has. I wasn't like this as a child.
No, me either. I used to read books all the time, quickly. Now I find myself having to read, you got to sit still and read, and then I'll get through it. But Audible books, I absolutely have been life-saving, and mine has done. So the Audible version is out, State of Emergency. It is a revisit of some things in history that we need to be talking about, for sure. Because, you know, it has been said many times that not only do we revisit, but we really have to listen and learn our history so we can understand the direction that we're traveling in. So there is a revisit in the book, but there is a strong prescription for how especially new people who are just entering this fight can get involved and find their space, find their lane. And I think the book also says we don't need your allies. We need you to be an accomplice. Mm-hmm. You got to make the same sacrifice. You got to be ready to go down just like I'm ready to go down. I tell people all the time, the critics, because, you know, we got the keyboard killers, honey. And I tell them all the YouTube videos.
That's the new one. We're going to say the keyboard killers.
keyboard the killers and the YouTubers. And I tell them all the time, if you really want to talk to me, meet me in a jail cell in Kentucky. Mm-hmm. Meet me in a jail cell in Washington, D.C. Meet me when it's hot, smoking hot, or in the middle of COVID when we were, you know, getting arrested and all the work. Meet me in the middle of an organizing space and say, okay, I can't go to jail. That's not a thing I can do. No problem. Just meet me in a city where we're outside doing real work.
And as far as the accomplices goes, we want them to meet you there too.
Well, the accomplices need to get there before I get there, right? That's what the accomplices are supposed to do. You need to go ahead of me. You know, there's a thing that happens in protests that I learned about in Kentucky, where they go and get all the white people and tell them to go to the front because...
I saw that in L.A., in Hollywood.
Right? Yeah, like you're like coming up against, a militarized police force that's not out there to say, hey, how you doing? Like, they are out there with force. And so they tell the white people, go to the front. And I saw white folks run. I said, well, this is some good. I like this thing right
you
here.
You saw that Joanne the Scammer video. She's like, all the white folk to the back. This time it's white folk to the front.
And I like that. I like this strategy. So, yeah, accomplices at that. When you make a decision that you are an accomplice in this movement, that means that you're ready to make a sacrifice and to take the same consequences that I have to take. So, you know, just like... You know, people send me death threats. Perhaps they might send one to you too.
Okay, be ready to die for it. Hey, you gotta be ready to die.
And I think that's an extreme.
Or at least go to jail. Or at least just get some threats.
Well, actually, I'll give you something that's a little more realistic, right? And by the way, I am prepared to die for what I believe in. And I've been in many circumstances where I could have died. Mm-hmm. But I think a more realistic way of describing it is just the idea of when people find out that you've been out there with someone like me, you might lose your friends, you might lose your job, your own mother may not talk to you anymore. Mm. And you gotta be prepared to give that up and to sacrifice not being liked by everyone, not being at the Thanksgiving table in order to stand up for what you believe in.
So it's more like sacrificing than comfort.
Absolutely.
Okay, well, State of Emergency is out May 11th. Yeah. Your virtual tour starts May 11th.
So you
plug everything. So the podcast, everything.
So Street Politicians is on iHeart Radio. You can download the app and wherever you find your podcast, by the way. So iHeart is one place, but our podcasts are everywhere.
Okay.
We're on YouTube, and we have a great partner in iWoman TV where they put out every week the video version of the podcast. So iWoman TV, one, okay. Also iHeart, and of course, it's the Black Effect Network, which is Charlamagne's podcast network that has a number of the best podcasts in the podcast world.
Thank you so much, Queen Tamika Mallory, for stepping into the shade room. It was all tea, no shade.
Well, you know, a little bit.
Okay. Well, you know, thank you so much, roommates. You know where to find everything.
Thank you so much for a great conversation.
Thank you.